going to go on with our second session, and I would like to introduce Dr. Luana Calabaro, who will be giving our second talk, start the second session. She received her medical degree from the University of Messina in Italy and had her board certification in hematology and medical oncology from the University of Messina. She did her postdoctoral studies at the Centro Riferimento Oncologico in Italy. She worked as a researcher at the National Institute of Health in Rome and later moved to Siena. Her research interests include cancer immunobiology and epigenetics, as well as bioimmunotherapy of solid tumors, with particular focus on thoracic malignancies. She has authored more than 50 international scientific publications in books, monographs, and peer-reviewed journals. She has been a principal investigator and co-investigators in the several key phase 1-3 trials in immunotherapeutic agents. So welcome. We're looking forward to your talk.
Well, good morning to everybody. Many thanks for the introduction, and I'd like to thank Professor Cameron for inviting me in this very exciting symposium. It's a pleasure to be here. In my talk, I'll do an overview about the development of the immune checkpoint inhibitors in malignant mesothelioma. As we know, immunotherapy is now considered an additional therapeutic option for cancer patients, in addition to the other treatment utilized for decades, such as surgery, chemotherapy, and radiotherapy. However, the immunotherapy is not a new strategy, because the first immunotherapeutic approach is starting more than one century ago. But only recently, the immunotherapy entering in the clinic with a growing number of immunotherapeutic agents approved for different tumor types. And this is due, in particular to the better knowledge of the complex mechanism operated by tumor cells for the immune escape, to the better knowledge of immunobiology of tumor cells, and the complex and dynamic interaction between the immune system and the tumor cells. And in particular, the success of immunotherapy comes from the identification of immune molecules expressed on our immune cells with the function to regulate the T-cell activation. And we learned that we can target these immune cells, that we can unleash efficiently anti-tumor immune response by targeting these immune molecules with monoclonal antibodies. The anti-CTLA-4 antibodies represent the prototype for this growing family of immunomodulating antibodies, firstly tested in metastatic melanoma patients, in which for the first time demonstrated that this class of antibodies, but more in general immunotherapy, is able to significantly improve the survival of patients with affected by metastatic melanoma. And here you see represented in a more simplified version of the mechanism of action of the anti-CTLA-4 antibodies. Briefly, as you know, for the T-cell activation, we require the two signals, the first one given from the interaction between the TCR and the antigen expressed on the APC, and the second signal is given from the binding between the co-stimulatory molecule CD28 and the B7. After the T-cell is activated, the inhibitor molecule CTLA-4 is expressed on the surface of the T-cell. CTLA-4 competes with CD28 to a higher affinity for the binding with B7. And after the binding of CTLA-4 and B7, the CTLA-4 induced generated inhibitor signals inside the T-cell that determine an inactivation of the T-cell. But this is a physiological mechanism operated by the T cells in order to prevent persistent status of T cell activation that could induce autoimmune disease. So we can, with the anti-CTLA-4 antibodies, block CTLA-4, prevent its binding with B7, so the T cell can restart it to inactivation status. And during the CTLA-4 development, the anti-CTLA-4 development, we learned that with this class of antibodies, but in general with the immunotherapeutic agents, we can observe the different kinetic of responses. I mean, we can observe the delayed objective responses. We can observe the initial progression of disease or disease control followed by progression of disease. But in general, the objective response, the disease control achieved by with the immunotherapeutic agents persistent over the time and have a positive impact in survival. And here you see an example. This is a Kaplan-Meier plot of survival of a clinical study investigating the efficacy of ipilimumab in combination with dacarbazine in comparison to dacarbazine in monotherapy in first-line metastatic melanoma patients. Well, as you can see here, for the first 4 months, you see here that the two curves are very similar. The initial benefit of ipilimumab started after the first 4-6 months from the beginning of treatment. And this benefit persisted for many months, for many years. In this study, patients had an improvement in survival over then 5 and more years. And this different mechanism of action is due because even if cytotoxic agents, the target is represented by tumor cells, so if treatment is effective, we can observe, treatment can induce rapid objective responses, as you can see here. But in general, the benefit from cytotoxic agents is not persistent over the time. Conversely, with immunotherapy, the target is represented by the immune cells and not by the tumor cells. So we can observe also delayed objective responses because the immune system required more time to be efficiently activated and to be able to recognize the tumor cells and kill them. But if we can observe the delayed responses with immunotherapeutic agents, in general, the responses are long-lasting and have a positive impact in survival. And this is why the ad hoc criteria of responses of immunotherapy are required because of the standard criteria, radiological criteria to define the responsivity to cytotoxic agents is not useful to determine the efficacy induced by immunotherapeutic agents in light of this different mechanism of action. So the immune-related response criteria were defined in the 2009, then evolved in immune-related RECIST criteria that we usually utilize in our clinical practice. The success of the anti-CTLA-4 antibodies, in particular of ipilimumab, prompted their investigation and the investigation of subsequent class of immunomodulating antibodies in almost tumor types, including mesothelioma. Mesothelioma, as we know, is a very hard to treat disease for unresectable patients. There are very limited therapeutic options available for these patients. The first line of treatment is still based on the platinum pemetrexed regimen, more or less combined with the bevacizumab, and there is no agents approved for second line. So the best therapeutic option for these patients is to put them in a clinical trials of course if available. And the different strategies have been investigated in order to improve the survival of these patients. And immunotherapy could be a potential strategies effective in this disease. And here you see different immunotherapeutic strategies currently ongoing in order to enhance, to improve the anti-tumor immunity in this disease. Some years ago, during the era of the development of the anti-CTLA-4 antibodies, we activated the first study, the MESOTO-TREM 2008, investigating the activity of tremelimumab in second-line mesothelioma patients. In this first study, we utilized the schedule of 15 mg per kilo once every 90 days because this was the schedule utilized in the pivotal study in metastatic melanoma patients. Despite the low rate of objective responses, only 7% of patients had achieved an objective responses, but this was consistent with the data generated with the anti-CTLA-4 antibodies in monotherapy also in other cancer histotypes. However, we observed interesting results in a disease control rate, and we observed that a subset of patients have a long-term benefit in survival. And here you see an example of atypical, unusual kinetic of responses that we can observe during treatment with immunotherapy. This is a patient with a pleural mesothelioma treated with tremelimumab in this first doses. Well, as you can see, these patients, after the first two doses of tremelimumab, had an initial progression of disease, but after four doses of tremelimumab, I mean after 1 year from the beginning of treatment, these patients achieved a significant and important partial response that persisted for much time. These patients achieved an almost complete response after 7 doses of treatment. And after 8 doses, these patients was discontinued from this study because of the onset of a neurological side effect. But this partial response was persistent for additional 2 years from the last dose of tremelimumab. So this is another important aspect we have to consider when we utilize immunotherapeutic agents. We can observe the persisting objective responses, persistent disease control rate, even after treatment discontinuation. Starting from these initial but promising results, then we activated the second study, the MESOTO-TREM 2012, investigating the activity of tremelimumab in the same setting of mesothelioma patients, but utilized a different schedule of administration, an intensified schedule of administration in light of data generated, of pharmacokinetic analysis generated in metastatic melanoma patients that strongly suggest a more intensified schedule of administration. In this second study, we observed a higher rate of objective responses, thus this study reached its primary endpoint, and the interesting data in disease control, 52% of patients achieved a disease control rate, and a small subset of patients had a long-term benefit in survival. In order to identify patients who could benefit from these therapeutic approaches, we performed translational studies in patients treated with tremelimumab in both studies. In particular, we studied the changes in the phenotype during the treatment with tremelimumab. And among different T-cell subpopulation studies, we in particular observed a dramatically increase in the high cost positive T-cells in both CD4, CD8 T-subset, T-cell subpopulation. And as you can see, this dramatic increase was already evident after 14 days from the first dose of tremelimumab and persisted throughout the cycle. Similar results were also observed in the second study, regardless of the different schedule of administration. But the more important is the finding that these changes in this T-cell subpopulation correlated with a better survival in both studies. Similar results we also observed in metastatic melanoma patients treated with the other anti-CTLA-4 antibodies, ipilimumab, regardless of the schedule utilized, 10 or 3 mg per kilo, thus suggesting that This T-cell subpopulation, ICOS-positive T-cell subpopulation, could represent a potential biomarker predictive of clinical benefit in patients treated with the anti-CTLA-4 antibodies, regardless of the kind of antibodies or schedule utilized. But of course, this data required further investigation in a large population. Our studies, MESOTO-3M studies, contribute for the design and the activation of a very large randomized international study, the DETERMINE studies, in which tremelimumab was investigated for efficacy at the intensified schedule of administration in comparison to placebo in second, third line mesothelioma patients. This was a very large study in which almost 600 of patients were enrolled. Unfortunately, this study failed to demonstrate an efficacy, an improvement in survival of tremelimumab, except for a small benefit in patients with sarcomatoid histotype. Probably different speculation we can do about this study. High levels of toxicity, in particular gastrointestinal toxicity, were found. Patients were discontinued from the study because of this toxicity after early doses of treatment. But probably, more probably, tremelimumab in monotherapy is enough to overcome the immunoresistance, immunosuppressive macroenvironment that characterize this disease. We know that mesothelioma has a relatively low mutational burden in comparison to other cancer diseases, such as melanoma or lung cancer patients, and evidence supports an association between a high mutational burden and a major response to CTLA-4 antibodies. So probably we have to utilize a more robust stimulus to induce an efficient anti-tumor response to mesothelioma. And in the last few years, a second generation of antibodies directed against the PD-1, PD-L1 axis was developed. As we know, this second class of antibodies has changed the therapeutic landscape of different tumor types. The growing number of anti-PD-1 and anti-PD-L1 has been approved for treatment in different tumor types and in different setting of disease. Different to CTLA-4, PD-1 acts in a late phase of T-cell activation with a role to maintain the peripheral tolerance. And with the anti-PD-1 or antibodies directed against PD-L1, we have observed more rapid objective responses, more effective, more efficacy in terms of high rate of disease control and improvement in survival in comparison to that observed with the anti-CTLA-4 antibodies. So there is a strong interest for this class of antibodies also in mesothelioma patients. And here you see results from the first study in which pembrolizumab was investigated in a small subset of patients of pleural pretreated mesothelioma patients selected for the PD-L1 status. Well, as you can see here, 20% of patients achieved partial responses and 72% of patients achieved disease control. Very interesting results if you consider that these patients were pretreated. And more interesting results are in median survival. The median survival of these patients was 18 months. So in light of these results, there are currently ongoing different growing number of clinical trials that are investigating the activity of different anti-PD-1, anti-PD-L1 in mesothelioma patients. Here I summarize in this table the initial results generated in other clinical trials with the pembrolizumab, nivolumab, avelumab, in which, as you can see, the partial response ranged from 10 to 24%, but more important is the results in disease control that ranged from 50 to 80% of patients. These are, of course, initial results, but very interesting. And here you see a clinical case of a patient affected by pleural mesothelioma treated in third line with pembrolizumab. As you can see, these patients had at the baseline a large tumor at the mediastinum, but just after 3 doses of pembrolizumab, we observed a dramatic decrease in this large tumor at mediastinum. And this patient is still in partial response after 1 year from the beginning of treatment. So with the anti-PD-1 and anti-PD-L1 antibody, we can observe the more rapid objective response than those observed with the anti-CTLA-4 antibodies. And this is another important aspect to consider, in particular in mesothelioma, in this aggressive disease. Well, the anti-PD-1, anti-PD-L1 antibodies seems to be active in this disease, but their efficacy is limited to more or less 20% of patients. So big efforts are now addressed to improve their activity, their efficacy. And there are currently under active investigation different combination of anti-PD-1, anti-PD-L1 antibodies with the other modalities. In particular, the anti-CTLA-4 antibodies could represent an optimal partner for combination with the PD-1, PD-L1 inhibitors because of the different mechanism of action. CTLA-4 and the PD-1 act in 2 different phases of T-cell activation. We can suppose a potential synergistic effect from the combination of these antibodies. And there are evidence demonstrating a more efficacy of the anti-CTLA-4 ipilimumab in combination with the nivolumab, the anti-PD-1 nivolumab in metastatic melanoma patients in comparison to nivolumab or ipilimumab utilized alone. And the combination of nivolumab and ipilimumab represent now the standard of care in first-line metastatic melanoma patients. And there are currently ongoing different clinical trials investigating the combination of the anti-CTLA-4 and the anti-PD-1, anti-PD-L1 in different tumor types. So, within the NIBIT Foundation, some years ago, we designed and activated the NIBIT MISO-1 study investigating the activity of tremelimumab in combination with the anti-PD-L1 antibody durvalumab in first or second line mesothelioma patients. The study started 2 years ago and last year we completed enrollment of 40 patients. Here you see the study design. Tremelimumab at a dose of 1 mg per kilo was combined with durvalumab at 20 mg per kilo for 4 doses, followed by treatment with only durvalumab in maintenance phase for additional 9 doses. For patients who had a progression disease during maintenance or follow-up phase, there was a chance, a possibility to restart the treatment from the combination. Primary endpoint of this study is to assess the objective response rate and the most secondary to assess the disease control rate, progression free survival, safety and overall survival. This study foresee also translational research in order to identify potential biomarkers of responses to this combination regimen. And here you see only preliminary results generated in the first 10 patients. As you can see here, 4 patients achieved at week 12 a partial response and 8% a disease control rate. At week 24, 33% of patients achieved a confirmed partial response and 56% a confirmed disease control rate. Final analysis in all 40 patients is still ongoing and will present this final analysis at the World Congress of Lung Cancer in Japan. Last ASCO meeting, we show the safety analysis of these patients treated with the combination. But overall, concerning safety, treatment was well tolerated. 70% of patients had high degree, severe, grade 3, 4 treatment-related toxicity. But in general, overall, these side effects were resolved after appropriate treatment. And here you see results show the task meeting of the combination of ipilimumab and nivolumab compared to nivolumab alone in a second third line mesothelioma patients. As you can see here, Professor Cameron showed the more updated results, but as you can see here, the combination was showed a slight improvement in disease control rate that was the primary endpoint of the study and an improvement in survival. Of course, concerning the safety, in this study were observed that the combination of treatment was characterized by high frequency of severe toxicity in comparison to nivolumab alone. But it's interesting to note that also in this study, the percentage of severe side effects was very similar to that observed in our study in IMBIT MISO 1. And there is currently ongoing a large phase 3 study investigating the efficacy of the combination of nivolumab and ipilimumab in comparison to first-line chemotherapy in first-line mesothelioma patients. Additional immune checkpoints are currently ongoing, and among these, the co-stimulatory ICOS represent a very interesting, very attractive pathway for targeting with immunomodulating antibodies. ICOS is involved in the the activation of the T cells, is a co-stimulatory pathway, and there is still very recently has been activated a phase 1 study investigating the safety of ICOS alone or in combination with the pembrolizumab in selected solid tumors, including mesothelioma. So in conclusion, we can say that immune checkpoint inhibitors, in my opinion, will play a major role in the next future for treatment of mesothelioma, but probably in combination with the other modalities. As we have seen, there are currently ongoing different clinical trials investigating the combination of immune checkpoint inhibitors with other immune checkpoints. Other optimal partners for the combination with immune checkpoint inhibitors could be the tumor microenvironment modulating agents, but in particular epigenetic agents, because of their ability to modify, to increase the immunogenicity of tumor cells. And our preliminary data generated at our lab are demonstrating a potential synergistic effect with the hypomethylating agents, the decitabine and the anti-CTLF in mesothelioma mouse model. This is the team in which I work. I'd like to thank my boss, and thank you very much for your attention.